few announcements as usual. As always, please remember to mark your attendance for us. We greatly appreciate it. Also, we have a few things coming up, and you probably saw the tables in the back. If you are interested in getting a cheese ball, they are taking orders for that today. That supports our youth group. So please make sure to check that out. The cost is $8 or $10. So please be aware of that. Also, there's another table. We have a Advent tea, ladies Advent tea coming up December the 10th. And so ladies, you are strongly encouraged with your families to sign up for that, get a ticket, and come for a great, wonderful afternoon together at that Advent tea. Also, our 2023 membership book is going to be coming out soon, and we want to make sure that we have everyone's correct contact information. One of the challenges that we have is getting in contact with people because sometimes the number has changed, or you just don't have that number anymore. So please make sure that we have good current contact info for you and your family, phone numbers, emails, whatever it is, and just get that to Crystal in the church office as soon as you can. We greatly appreciate that. And with that, let's go ahead and begin our worship service with the ringing of the bell, and please stand for confession and absolution. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God our Father, most merciful God.
We confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre, with the lyre and the sound of God, with trumpets. wonders, for God is the Lord. And God has done wonders, for God is the Lord. And God has done wonders, oh sing to our God, oh sing to our God.
For you, their worship,
Lord be with you. O Lord, almighty and ever-living God, you have given exceedingly great and precious promises to those who trust in you. Rule and govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may live and abide forever in your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of God's holy word. The Old Testament reading is from Malachi chapter 4. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that is coming shall set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you who fear my name, the Sun of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. You shall go out leaping like calves from the stall, and you shall tread down the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says the Lord of hosts. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and just decrees that I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter desolation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Finally, brothers, pray for us, that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored, as happened among you, and that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men. For not all have faith, but the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. And we have confidence in the Lord about you, that you are doing and will do the things that we command. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Now we command you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you keep away from any brother who is walking in idleness and not in accord with the tradition that you receive from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to imitate us, because we were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But with toil and labor we worked night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you. It was not because we do not have that right, but to give you and ourselves an example to imitate. For even when we were with you, we would give you this command: if anyone is not willing to work, let him not eat. For we hear that some among you walk in idleness, not busy at work, but busy bodies. Now, such persons we command and encourage in the Lord Jesus Christ to do their work quietly and to earn their own living. As for you, brothers, do not grow weary in doing good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Holy Gospel. Gospel according to St. Luke, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
While some were speaking of the temple, how it was adorned with noble stones and offerings, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." And they asked him, "Teacher, when will these things be? And what will be the sign when these things are about to take place?" And he said, "See that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and 'The time is at hand.' Do not go after them. And when you hear of wars and tumults, do not be terrified, for these things must first take place. But the end will not be at once." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and pestilences. And there will be terrors and great signs from heaven. But before all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. And you will be brought before kings and governors for my name's sake. This will be your opportunity to bear witness. Settle it therefore in your minds not to mediate. Meditate beforehand how to answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which none of your adversaries will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be delivered up even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends. And some of you they will put to death. You will be hated by all for my name's sake, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance you will gain your lives. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation has come near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let those who are inside the city depart. And let not those who are out in the country enter it, for these are days of vengeance, to fulfill all that is written. Alas for women who are pregnant, and for those who are nursing infants in those days, for there will be great distress upon the earth, and wrath against this people. They will fall by the edge of the sword, and be led captive among all nations, and Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles, until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And there will be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on the earth distress of nations and perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and the waves, people fainting with fear and with foreboding of what is coming on the world. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated.
Say that, that's wrong. But doesn't he kind of have a point? At least a little bit. I mean, where did that food come from? Jesus talks about in the Sermon on the Mount that we shouldn't worry and fret. God's going to take care of us. And he says, consider the birds of the air. God takes care of them. They have enough to eat. They're not worried about it. So why do you? But have you ever watched birds? When the little hatchlings are born and the beaks stick up out of the neck, the bird spends all day flying back and forth and back and forth trying to feed all of these young little beaks sticking up out of the nest. And then they spend all fall building new nests, you know, for the next generation. They do a lot of work. So which is it? Is God taking care of these helpless little baby birds? Or are the grown-up birds taking care of these helpless little baby birds? Well, Jesus' point is, don't worry, don't fret. But his point isn't, don't do anything. It's what you do, do with confidence that your will is aligned with God's will and that you are, in fact, instruments in God's hands. So when we talk about stewardship, that's kind of what we're talking about. We are talking about being God's means of doing things. And the ultimate example of that is probably children. Last night we had, the whole preschool was here, so the church was packed, and there was just young children everywhere. And think about that. What they sang was, I am baptized, happy day, all my sins were washed away, God looked down on me and smiled, I became his own dear child. Children are God's. They're his children. He's entrusted them to parents to take care of his children for him. Parenting is stewardship of a whole person. Think of what a privilege, but also a daunting task that is. Because we teach those children that God cares for them. God feeds and clothes them. God looks over them. God does everything for them. And yet if you're a parent, you know, wait a minute, you're the one doing that. So being a steward of God's child is totally self-sacrificial. And every parent knows the amount of self-sacrifice that the minute that baby comes into the world, your house is that baby's house. Your time is that baby's time. Your money is that baby's money. Your energies, your thoughts are directed outward somewhere. And sometimes you don't even notice just how self-sacrificial your life becomes because, of course, you're motivated by love. But sometimes you start to notice the self-sacrifice. When the baby is crying or when the little kid is got a fever in the middle of the night and throwing up in the bathroom and crying out for you, you can't just roll over in bed and say, oh, you know, God's got this one. It's his kid. You can't do that. No matter how much you struggle with it, it still kind of depends upon you to be a good steward of God's child. So that's the paradox. In the Christian life, you have to work as though everything depends upon you, secure in the knowledge that nothing depends upon you. How do we reconcile that? Well, it's stewardship. God working through us. It is trying to make our will God's will, so that what we do without even thinking about it ends up being what God wants us to do without even thinking about it, because God working and our working is the same thing. And we're not there yet. Never will be in this life, because our own proud, sinful nature resists that whole idea and wants to work towards self-absorption, self-centeredness, and just looking out for number one. So in the bulletin, it talks about time, talent, and treasures. And those are usually kind of the three things that we think of that God has entrusted to you to be a steward of. God gives you your time, your life, your lifespan. He He gives you your abilities and your talents. Whatever it is that you're capable of doing and being is a gift. And of course, everything that you have, you know, the material goods and wealth and so forth, is a gift. Time, talents, and treasures. So the question is, what will you do with it? What will you do, like a bird with little babies in the nest? How are you going to spend your time and your energy? What are you going to do with the worm that you catch? Well, stewardship means taking all that God has made you and given you and using it to serve God's will. Again, easier said than done. Because kids have time, talents, and treasures, but it all comes from their parents. Parents gave them life, gave them a place, gave them food, gave them clothes, taught them to do things, raised them up to maximize their abilities. And yet they're God's children. So the first thing that we have to do to develop a good stewardship mindset is to put ourselves in the place of the children in that equation. Most people sitting here are probably putting themselves in the place of the adults. First and foremost, realize that all this God does, He gives you, food and drink, clothing and shoes, house and home, all of this He does only out of fatherly, divine goodness and mercy without any merit or worthiness in me. God doesn't take care of you because you deserve it. He just does because He loves you. You are on the receiving end of that grace and that love. Like a little bird just opening its mouth, somebody feed me. And God does. Using instruments, means. St. Paul talks about this in the life of the church when he says, his example is, anyone who is not willing to work, let him not eat. Earn your living. All right. But if you've earned it, then how is it God's grace? If all this He does only out of fatherly divine goodness and mercy, then how can He say, go out and earn it? And there again, those are two separate concepts in a way, because the fact that you earned it doesn't mean that it wasn't God's grace. It means that God's gift of a means to make a living was utilized in accordance with God's will so that your will and God's will aligned. And if you're lazy and self-centered and you just want other people to do all the work, then your will and God's will don't align. And you need to be rebuked and you need to be called to repentance. Grace is not the opportunity for idleness, but grace does transform your will. Most parents are so self-sacrificial with their children, not because they feel some sort of obligation or because they checked in their catechism and found out that it's their job. It's what they naturally want to do because they love their child. And God's self-sacrificial love for you is shown in Jesus Christ, who gave Himself up for you. Not because you deserve it, not because you're one of the good ones, but strictly because He said, I love you enough to die for you as your heavenly Father and as your Creator. I become your Redeemer. And He gives us that example. So if you've been entrusted with a child, maybe that's what you do. You've certainly been entrusted with yourself, with your body and soul and all things. God takes care of it. He also charges you with stewardship of it. What will you do with your body? St. Paul says it's not meant for self-indulgence and sexual immorality and all that. It's meant for holiness. You are a steward of a temple of the Holy Spirit, your own body. God has also made us stewards of St. Paul's. This building was here long before I got here. And before this building was here, There were people working downtown at the old building, and before that building was there, there were people trying to build up a ministry. And what it was we are charged with bringing that message from generation to generation to generation until the end of time. We are stewards of the very gospel. When the little kids were singing it, it was so joyous because over the course of hundreds and even thousands of years, that's been handed down from generation to generation. So it's neat to see 3- and 4-year-olds saying, "I was baptized, happy day, all my sins were washed away." They're learning it. And maybe someday they'll be sitting out here and there'll be a fresh crop of 3- and 4-year-olds. Who knows? We don't know the future. But we do know that we are entrusted, we are made stewards of this mission, St. Paul's Lutheran Church and School, this ministry, and most importantly, this gospel. So God has made you all that you are and all that you have. What will you do with it? How will we be stewards? How will God's will and our will align? Because the purpose is not to hassle and harangue people into giving more or, you know, donating something. The purpose is to say, you are a steward. And God has put opportunities in front of you. What are those opportunities in your life? Most importantly, we trust that we aren't risking ourselves by being self-sacrificial, because we are on the receiving end of the grace, the receiving end of the mercy and forgiveness whereby God self-sacrificially loves us enough to die for us, but then comes out of the tomb. He loves us enough to claim us with this guarantee of victory. So nothing depends upon you. And yet, it all depends on what we decide to do in terms of aligning our will with God's will for our time, talents, and treasures, our lives, our families, and all that we are. And we do so with the promise that His claim, His bringing you into His family, is permanent. He's never going to give up. So our failures, He'll wipe away, He'll forgive. Again and again, always raising us up to be the people who can steward the mysteries of Christianity, the mysteries of God's grace, be fed in Holy Communion as people receiving mercy and forgiveness to be His children forever. We are stewards, but we're not just servants, we're children of God. In Jesus' name, amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard and keep our hearts and our minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Rise, and we unite our voices and confess our shared faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God. Begotten, not made, being of one
crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For steadfastness in the word of God, which will never pass away, that in these last days we may turn our eyes from the distress of this failing world and lift them to Christ, our help and keeper. Let us pray to the Lord. For ministers of the gospel and those who hear it gladly, especially all persecuted Christians, that they may be delivered from wicked and evil men, be given a mouth and wisdom to confess Christ boldly and endure faithfully to the end. Let us pray to the Lord. For the homes and businesses of this congregation, that according to the apostolic command, we may remain busy at work and not walk in idleness. See the fruits of our labors and have hearts directed to the love of God and the steadfastness of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. For deliverance from fear as we witness the signs of the times, that we would make sober judgment in the face of so many vexing concerns, and for the assurance that, though the nations rage and the powers press against the church, this is our opportunity to give witness to the word that does not change and to the mercy that is our hope in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those celebrating wedding anniversaries, especially Rocky and Marcia, and Thomas and Carolyn, for Ray, and all those celebrating another year of life given to them by our Creator, let us pray to the Lord. For those in affliction, that they may endure in hope and raise up their heads as they await the coming of their redemption, Christ Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who eat and drink the body and blood of Jesus, that God would give us repentant hearts to receive the forgiveness of sins and to proclaim joyfully Christ's death until he comes in glory. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord God, Heavenly Father, as the days pass and all things move to their appointed end, keep us from being complacent. Keep us alert and awake so that when the day comes, we may greet you and rejoice in your eternal salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Lift
up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary, for our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy.
Oh,
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin, to be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Consumed by the fire. thanks to Almighty God that you have refreshed us through this solitary year. We implore you for your mercy to strengthen us in the same in faith for you and in fervent love for one another. For Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
We sing our closing hymn.
Salvation is at hand.
Good morning.
Joy to the nations when
Good morning.
Jesus is King.
Good morning.
Come, let us sing a song declaring that He belongs to Jesus.
Good morning.
He's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus.
Good morning, sir.
Sing to the King.
Good morning. Blessings.
For His returning.
Good morning.
We watch and we pray. We will be ready the dawn.